All right, let's roll.
Oh, hold on. I was muted whilst doing a welcoming intro. So welcome, everyone. I'm going to still be moving around a fair bit. I'm Sanson, going to be hosting for the day, just as I try to get my sun set up with some form of distraction for the start of this. So I hope you don't mind getting a little bit seasick whilst I move around and click on things. We're going to be talking about what we can learn from musicals. And at the moment, I'm setting him up watching music videos. At least that's what I'm trying to do. So welcome, everyone. In the chat, why not say where you are calling in from? That is, or zooming in from. That's always a fun thing to see. So just do go and say, oh, we've got someone from Canada, Madrid. Oh, very exciting. Newcastle. Ah,
yes,
gosh almighty. There is all manner of places. You've got Bellingham coming in. Some of these places in Oakland. Does that mean that people are watching it at 3 a.m?
Oh my God.
Got Hove. We've got Harrow.
Someone's written
Tottenham, T-O-T-N-A-M. And either that is, you know, just Tottenham. in a sort of more phonetic spelling, or else, I don't know, maybe it's a delightful village somewhere in Somerset. So no matter where you're calling in from, it is lovely to have you here. And we're going to be, you know, probably get started a little slow, just give everyone a time to log in, to sort of get confused with Zoom and all the various other important things which need to be done before any event. There we go. We've got the sound of my son really crying out there for some form of entertainment. Ragnar, do you want to go and say hi? Hello. Look there. There we go. Temporary distraction whilst we just go and get started up. Ragnar, do you have anything important to add? What musicals do you like? Yeah, the ones on that, the different computer, that is the, we'd all prefer if those were working, mate. Not just you. Yes, welcome one, welcome all. Are we starting now, Stephanie? We good to go?
Yeah, maybe in another minute.
Another minute?
Yeah, I'll give it
okay,
another minute.
Good. Let's go and see if anyone else has joined in. Yeah, if you are new to join, just do say where you... Oh, someone's saying, hi, Ragnar. There we go. Oh, look at that. The little guy is having... he just so wants to see sound and vision coming from the screen. It's just really... all he's about. There's a good morning. There we go. That's nice. I have right now found him a GIF. I've gone into a presentation because the internet's not working, and I found him a GIF of some grass growing from seeds to sprouts. And I'm just wondering, how long will this keep him entertained for? I mean, it is not great viewing. But so far, I mean, he's literally all he wants. He wants to see things move on screen, and that's good for the moment. So, welcome everyone to Sunday Assembly. We've got someone calling in from Melbourne there. Oh, look, I really hope that everything is okay for you in lockdown. And I'm just going to say, I hope that it's... okay for everyone. I think we're all sort of experiencing it. Most countries seem to, sort of coming up to this realization that, oh no, it's not going to be over by September. And indeed, it's going to get worse. This Yeah, on Monday I went for a COVID test. That's a sort of my interaction with the system, and it's really amazing. They get it back to you within 3 days, which is the sort of top quality testing regime we've been longing for. literally distracting my son now by showing him a presentation that I did to a sort of communications agency. And it turns out that he really likes seeing slides. So there we go. That is, he's now at the moment getting a sort of overview on lifefulness, which is a useful thing for anyone to have. Well done, him. There we go. If YouTube could be working now, it would be amazing. Yeah, so welcome everyone to Sunday Assembly. There's, oh my gosh, we have got an amazing situation there. We have got two Catherine Olivers in this meeting. Is there a way that we can sort of get the Kate Olivers and unmute them? I think we need to have this meeting of Oliver. Where's an Oliver? Oh. Two Kate Olivers, indeed. We should all be very excited by this. I mean, we've said for many times that once there are two Kate Olivers in one Sunday Assembly, then the prophecy will be complete. So
we each have one half of a medallion.
Oh, look, there's some Kate Oliver love. What's better than one Kate Oliver? Two Kate Olivers. Great joke, Stuart. Well done. We're sort of workshopping it live here. I don't know whether we should. Oh, look, there's one Kate Oliver. Yeah.
Thanks for spotlighting me. I had clearly not planned to be on.
Oh, and there's the other Kate. It's a Catherine Oliver.
Looking good.
Oh my gosh. Oh, it's a knockout because we have not one KO, but two KOs here. It's a total knockout, TKO. The puns are not stopping. And in this very moment, the internet has chosen to work. And I am now feeding him Peppa Pig. So, oof. That is good. I think we're going to start. We're going to be able to start soon.
Oh, yeah, God, let's do it.
I've got the camera turning round, and so it's not like only concentrated on the part of the house which is tidy and zoomable, but in fact just all the child stuff which has been pushed around it in order to go and be presentable. So yeah, welcome to Sunday Assembly, everyone. The theme of this Sunday Assembly is what we can learn from the musicals. And, you know, in this controversial time, I think it is important that Sunday Assembly is a place where we can discuss topics which divide people. Because, guys, I'm just going to say, wave your hands if you're a musical fan. Let's go and have a look what's happening in the gallery. There we go. There's some musical fans here. And now I'm going to say, wave your hands if musicals, I'm just going to say actually sideways hands, if musicals, you can sometimes be a bit take it or leave it. There we go. That's it. Look. Oh, we even got someone doing a thumbs down there. And I saw at least was one person doing more like an umpire in the cricket. It's four runs there. The sort of musical fans there was a big shaking of heads there. You do not want to get them angry because they will go into a fabulous pose and it will just go and really knock your socks off. But we've got an amazing speaker who's going to be talking about what we can learn from musicals. And that means that we've got songs which are from the musicals. And I'm a musical fan. I might even say that I'm a musical stan. So I'm really excited by this. And I'm so glad to have so many people here. It is wonderful in this time when we're so disconnected to have these moments we can come together. So yeah, are we ready to do the first song? All right, gang. If you want to stand up, stand up. Why not? Like, it's a fun thing. Like, go and have a dance. So I'm going to pop myself on mute. There we go. How we do that? And yeah, just give it a red hot go.
Of Santa Fe. We were 17, but he was sweet and it was true. Still, I did what I had to do, 'cause I just knew. Summer Sunday nights, we'd sink into our seats right as they dimmed out all the lights. A technicolor world made out of music and machine. It called me to be on that screen and live inside your seat. Not a nickel to my name.
It's a deep cut, starting on musicals, and the musical theatre kids have gone, yeah. I don't just want you to love me for the things that you know. I want you to love me for love musicals for the rare and unusual ones. But what is better than one musical song?
Two songs!
random words.
Consider yourself at home. Consider yourself one of the family. We've taken to you so strong. It's clear we're going to get along. Consider yourself well in. Consider yourself part of the furniture. There isn't a lot to spare. Your chance to be, we should see some harder days, empty larder days. Why grouse? Always a chance we'll meet somebody to foot the bill, then the drinks are on the house. Consider yourself our mate. We don't want to have no fuss, for after some consideration we can say, consider yourself one of us. Consider yourself
that's not really a song, that's a tour de force. Wow, hello. Unmute myself. This is the tricky thing when you see a video like that, and there have been two excellently prepared videos, and there's many arguments to say that in so many ways, the first video was technically better. But there was a glorious gusto to that Matt's, not attempt, huge success, I would say. Now I'm suddenly swinging back pro musicals. What exciting turn of events already. And we're just at the start of this. And so, yeah, like, I don't know if, you know, for me, the sort of musicals started, you know, pretty early on in life. It was musicals in the car. There was the ones, Joseph and his Technicolor Dream Coat, then Phantom of the Opera. There's also the musicals, which I sort of only know the words to, but have never actually sort of seen the musical as well. And yeah, it is, there's something glorious about them. There is such a attempt to really channel emotion, and there's a certain sort of like shamelessness in a sort of world where there's often so much irony that it's just putting it all out there. And so I am so excited to go and hear, you know, what we can really learn from them, from someone who is someone who's a director and a writer who we're going to have next. But we're going to start off with a poet, Faye Roberts. So I'm going to ask everyone, wherever you are, to go and give them a huge, big, welcoming round of applause on National Poetry Day. Give them a big clap.
Unmute. Awesome. It all worked. Okay. So for some reason, I decided that yesterday I would just write a brand new poem for this rather than kind of shoehorn something in that was vaguely appropriate. So yeah, you can read the text along with it if you like. This one is called once more, or what I learned from what people learned from musicals, a crowdsourced poem. Meine Damen und Herren, Mesdames et Messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, are you ready to learn what I've learned? It's a whole new world, a strange journey, and I see you tremble with anticipation. The creation of a musical microcosm of reality can be costly, but don't worry, I'll be gentle. You ain't never had a friend like me. Ready? And I know things now, many valuable things that I hadn't known before. And a score of reminders of discoveries in theatres or bundled up on sofa'd sick days, uncovering the array of human experience, peeled down to what can be delivered at half the pace of human speech over a couple of hours, with interval. You don't have to sit around complaining about the way your life has wound up, but you can turn it into song, invite the world to sing along, and maybe at the end you'll feel much better, well, connected anyway. And you may walk away with the impression that ethical standards can be predicted by vocal pitch and a presence of syncopation, but baby, real villains don't come accompanied with percussive warning labels. But the tigers come at night with their voices soft as thunder, and I understand more about found family. You're a jet all the way, and how selling your soul and hair and teeth for safety is a shorter term solution than you might believe. And if you don't say or sing what you mean soon, it can be too late. And what a great waste of plant food an abusive dentist makes. I've learned that 525,600 minutes is shorter than you'd think for all it's been a long year, but we can share the facts of Hamilton's 51 essays, the way everything ain't free in America, prickly pears are best picked, poorless opium wars are fought for awful causes, the poor should pick a pocket or two, and how in just 7 days he'll make a man out of you. I'm glad we've got this new technology for seeing each other with the world locked. Instead of jockeying for toilet roll, we can stay home to sing along, not forgetting that tomorrow belongs to me, because not everyone who summons good intent is bent on the same values as you. And frankly, Nazis are everywhere in musicals too, a true reflection of what might beset us if we forget whose money makes the world go around. You've got to be carefully taught, because the more fraught messages can filling up defences, but picket fenced and bathed in tunes from dapper gents and sassy dames, they can ring, unregarded but working miracles under the skin, buried deep in synapses that are slowly forming brand new chains of meaning as catchy repetition literally changes your mind. Do you hear the people sing? Because the supportive chorus is glorious. And we adore syncretic miracles weaving street sweepers and aristocracy and high kicks and pretty harmonies, but more than this, she tells me, it isn't for the few to tell the many what to do, and we should choose which songs to sing and with whom. Consider yourself at home, because no one doesn't have a place in musicals. Can't sing? Have a comic role. Can't dance? Says who? But anyway, it's overrated. See, there's so much more you can do beyond the stage to make the glitter linger longer in people's glee-starved souls. They had it coming, apparently. I've been handed horror stories of all the incautious directors of musicals who neglect to check their props, stock up on body mic batteries, flatter the pianist appropriately, or let the band attend the bar beforehand. And oh, it's messy, but the show goes on. And now it's midnight. Like, I literally wrote this line at midnight and I couldn't have been more delighted. Yes, I need to get a life, or maybe just outside, and I need to find an ending to this piece, a triumphal closing chord to call this to a halt, and all the while finding time to tell you that it doesn't matter that neither elephants nor jazz hands can make you fly, but that life is also the song you sing in fits and starts, between the mundane, the joy, between the admin, the applause, between the tragedy, the soaring choruses, and that some of these are the same thing. It's a hard knock life, it's true, and you could dismiss this as bread and circuses, but for the subversive messages served up as hope that singing in the rain is sometimes the best way to make the most of things when times are tough, and that if the chorus is large enough, its harmonies can overwhelm the best laid plans of even the greatest single orchestrators. You choose. What adventures we're going to have together. Meine Damen und Herren, Mesdames et Messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, where are your troubles now? Forgotten? I told you so. We have no troubles here. here. Life is beautiful. Auf Wiedersehen. A biento. Goodbye.
Yeah. Wow. I'm amazing. Oh my gosh. People were going off there. Thick with references to many, many musicals. Guys, just go in the chat and why not just say which references you spotted there, which ones made you happiest. There were so many, and now that I'm talking, I should have gotten jotted them down. You know, obviously, there was Consider Yourself in there. We got Do You Hear the People Sing? Cabaret in Chicago, Rent, oh yes. There we go, there's some lovely Les Mis. There's some Guys and Dolls and Jets. Oh, Annie, the Rocky Horror, yes, I liked that one. And someone has said here, homage to Matt Lockwood, Oliver the Musical. I mean, Matt Lockwood did look like he could be in a gang of pickpockets there. Thanks so much, Faye. That was amazing. And we are now going to be moving into another song. And this was a musical, which... And this is another one where I haven't seen the film yet, but I have got introduced to some of the songs from it, and they are absolute bangers. So everyone, stand up if you want to. You don't have to, but it would be good if you did, because it gets you moving a bit. And then we're going to be having another song. So are we ready for that? Technical team? No, maybe we're... Unless I'm much mistaken, I really did think there was a song now.
I believe there's a song now.
Yeah.
Is Aaron okay, there?
Good. I mean, we can do the song after the main speaker if Aaron's been taken out by some Zoom-based...
Oh, here it is.
There we go.
Door through where no one's been.
Wowzers. Oh, hold on, I'm keeping being muted and unmuted. The first time that I took the Greatest Showman out and used it in a, it was a talk I gave to a school, and the kid, and I think the eldest kids were 13, and it was 8 to 13-year-olds, and they went insane. It was, we kicked off with Let It Go, which, like, is really sort of unfair. That's like giving them a load of crack sort of based Haribo sour mix or something like that. And then to do the double whammy of Frozen and then The Greatest Showman, there's just need to go and get the right track from it. What was it again? I'll go and I think This Is Me. Oh my gosh. Yeah, it was insane. And so, well, look, thank you so much to all, everyone who's made the videos there and everyone for singing so much. It is now time for our main speaker. And so we're, you know, we've been enjoying the songs. You're right, Kate Oliver. This Is Me does kill. Hold on. So please put your hands together for our guest speaker, Ray Rackham. Oh, Rackham is a great name for puns. I mean, it's very good.
Yeah, Rackham is a great name for puns. It's also a name that gets mixed up pretty much every time anyone ever introduces me. So thank you very much for getting it right. Well, thank you, everyone. I'm really pleased to be here. And you know, I'd forgotten how much I rack them up, exactly. How much I enjoyed The Greatest Showman, and particularly that song. You know, I don't care, call me crazy, we can live in a world we design. That's a pretty awesome message, you know, right there. I might as well just stop. However, you know, if this is the world we've designed, the cynic in me might say, what on earth were we thinking? There's two sides to every story. So, I'm going to try and share my screen because I'm coming to you. I'm a child of 1980-something, so I'm coming to you with the means and medium of a PowerPoint presentation. So let's see if I can do this. I mean, I'm not sure if I can. To be honest, I don't trust myself to do anything most of the time. But it looks like it's kind of worked. Let's do a slideshow from the beginning. Hopefully you can see this. Just nod if you can. Okay, brilliant. All right. So yeah, I'm quite honored to be here today. And it's been a while since I've done any public speaking at all. So I am a little bit out of practice, as the kids say these days. So if I burst into song at any given moment, you know, forgive me, because that is what people in musicals do, right? I mean, that's all they do, isn't it? Let's have a look. So I guess in many ways I've spent the best part of my adult life surrounded by the world of musical theatre. Picture it. You know, it all started with a portable television. December 25th, 1980-something. And while the rest of my family were, you know, pretty much falling asleep in front of the TV or arguing over who was going to have to get up and change the channel, the incredibly precocious version of me was sitting in my room waiting for my dad to try and tune in my Christmas present, which was, drumroll, a portable color television. You know, those were the days where you had to manually tune in the TVs. It was like an East End version of Star Trek, me holding an antenna in various places around my room and my dad tuning in the dial with the precision of a safecracker. All the while, we had tiny fragments of sound coming from our attempt to tune in one of three channels. Remember, guys, this was 1980-something. We only had three channels. And after what seemed like an eternity, the white noise was replaced by the distant sound of strings. And the television static faded to a grainy, almost sepia hue. And I was devastated because I was expecting full-on Goonies, He-Man, She-Ra-inspired Technicolor. And what I got was this young girl wandering around a barnyard with her dog. You know, my tastes were not really that distinguishable at that point. So all I saw was a black and white movie. I didn't see the sepia. And she seemed to be singing about how all the world was a hopeless jumble. And, you know, in my world, Christmas was ruined. But then I heard the incredibly familiar sound of Over the Rainbow. Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a land that I dreamed of once in a lullaby. Blimey. Fast forward, it's now 2000-something, and I'm working as a director in the theatrical arts. I'm very fancy. And my production of Stephen Sondheim's Assassins had just closed at the Pleasance Theatre in London. Now, Assassins is pretty awesome, actually. It's a musical about the men and women who have attempted, and in some cases succeeded, in assassinating various presidents of the United States of America. Not really jazz hands musical theatre-y, but you know, the musical theatre is an all-inclusive congregation. It was quite a good production, if I say so myself. We were starred quite poorly in the times, but we got a really, really good review from USA Today. We were winners all. And I think that production cemented my love affair with Stephen Sondheim. And this is a love affair with his songs and the genius of his lyrics and how they speak to you. And it's probably the greatest love of my life. A fact, I was very lucky to be able to tell Mr. Sondheim when I met him in New York last year. And it's the only time I've ever heard a person simultaneously be lost for words and clear their throat. But Assassins was closed. And I had the good fortune to be offered a position as the artistic director of London Theatre Workshop. Now, this was to have a fancy pants new venue in Fulham above a pub. And I understood the rooms above pubs in Fulham were far more fancier than the rooms above pubs in the East End, so I jumped at the chance. I was also trying my luck at being like a lyricist. You know, I thought if Stephen Sondheim can do it, I can as well. And I made my contribution to the musical Apartment 40C. That was fun. I also then adapted, or tried to at least, adapt a film to the stage. That amounted to pretty much nothing. One might safely say I found my space in the world. My little place where happy little bluebirds fly. And you know what? It was in the musical theater, the stage. But now, this was 2000 and something at this point, and the much revered dinner party had made a comeback. I was fortunate enough to be invited to one. And it must have been the refined room above a pub in Fulham that swung it, because it was in Sloane Square. So off I went, mustering my usual gumption, and proceeded to dominate the cocktail conversation. I was almost a cross between kind of Bette Midler, Liberace, and James Corden. My host clearly had been very gracious in discreetly moving me to the other side of the table. I imagine in the hope that my cocktail conversation would be lost in the clinking of glasses and clanking of knives and forks. But, and this has featured very heavily in my career, I lucked out. I was sat next to the elderly producer of a 1963 film, I Could Go On Singing. You know, she said, it was Judy's last movie. Judy who? Are you putting me on? She then proceeded to tell me anything and everything about the legend that is Judy Garland. Oh, you mean Liza's mum? She didn't talk to me for the rest of the evening. But fast forward another few years, and it's now 2017, and my show, Judy, opened in the West End. Now, remember that really poorly review of my show years ago? The Times said Judy was glittering. I think they were referring to the lights, but I could be wrong. And the proceeds I got from Judy, I used to open a musical theatre sing-along bar, because that's what you do. I opened Overtures, where we sing and dance all night, 6 hours of musical theatre show tunes, and those patrons can sing and dance all night, never go home. And then March happened, and we closed, and we've never reopened. Wow. That was a bummer, right? What a depressing way to end the story. I mean, there was no musical theatre-esque Judy and Mickey movie where we put a show on in the barn and we saved all of our fortunes. You know, we didn't tap dance our way across Trafalgar Square, reopening the musical theatre sing-along bar in a blaze of glory. No, nothing. Zip, zilch. But, you see, however sad I was, however depressed I felt, I couldn't help but think of the dozens, if not hundreds, of lyrics that had kind of found a way into my head, having spent years listening to them at Overtures Piano Bar. You know, I'd be washing up, and out of the blue, I'd question, how do you really measure a year? And FYI, it's not 525,600 minutes. It's 525,960.2 minutes. But I don't think that really fits in the song as well. So we won't split hairs. I'd also, you know, I'd be taking out the bins and I'd get really dressed up for it, but I'd be singing inside my heart, I want to be where the people are. And when I realized that the people like me were in lockdown, the only thing I could think about were the merry murderesses of the Cooks County Jail. Pop. Six. Squish. Cicero and Lipschitz. You know, why do these songs, they infiltrate our subconscious, they stay in the dark caverns of our mind, and they appear when we need them? Or why do they surprise us out of the blue when we least expect them to? They're like little peacock feathered earworms, always ready and willing to provide comfort, solace, highlight our idiosyncrasies, and sometimes make some really sarcastic comments on life. You know, the answer, which I'm guessing is the answer to most existential questions, is that they just are. There's something about the marriage between lyric and music, the fact that somehow the characters in musicals sing as a means to express themselves, comment on what's going on, or simply because words alone are not enough to describe the feelings these characters have or the world they inhabit. I mean, let's be honest, 2020, there have been many moments since that New Year's Eve bell fell in Times Square, where I've struggled to articulate what I was feeling or what I was going on or what was going on in the world around me. And not just the coronavirus, but how the world and all of us in it are changing at such an alarmingly complex rate. Sometimes I felt I was the only person in the world struggling to keep up. So what did I do? I turned to those songs to help me understand a bit about the world, my place in it, where I was going and who, if anyone, was going with me. I'd sing in the bath. I'd hum while brushing my teeth. I'd tap out a dance break on my dining room table with my fingers. You know, I even bought a T-shirt that said, "The voices in my head sing show tunes." I mean, I only wore it once. So maybe I turned to the musical theatre, but what did it teach me? And what, if anything, can it teach us? Well, let's go to some of the big ticket items first. Let's talk about some of the universal themes. Love. That universal condition that has plagued philosophers since the dawn of time, love features heavily in the musical theatre. Be it the immediate first sight love of Tony and Maria in West Side Story, or that kind of gradual, "Oh my, I think I might be falling for you," that Maria has for Captain Von Trapp. Or that first throw of a summer love that makes Sandy from Greece ditch the taffeta and buy some questionably tight-fitting trousers. I mean, love is examined probably more than any other issue or theme known to humankind. And I'm not certain, as Moulin Rouge would suggest, that love is all you need. I mean, food, water, a roof over your head, you know, they have to feature at some point. But I'd certainly agree with Annie, Get Your Gun. which puts it simply that love is a wonderful thing. Now, don't get me wrong, musicals don't only deal with the positives of love. They deal with a whole bunch of negatives. You know, one of the most depressing songs I've ever heard is from the last 5 years, and it's called Still Hurting, and it captures that gut-wrenching sadness you had when you realise the person you once loved has moved on and is happy, and you're like a slobbering mess of a human being. And, you know, as Kathy says, what about me? What about me? And also being blinded by someone, you know, that very obvious downsides that a person might have because of some kind of immature infatuation. I mean, it's all very well being 16 going on 17, but if the boy that you're going on 17 with has some questionable political stances, you might want to reconsider your life choices. I mean, to conclude on the matter of love, I think Moulin Rouge redeems itself a little bit when it says, the greatest thing you'll ever learn is just to love and be loved in return. I mean, that's quite awesome, isn't it? And it's not just about that soppy moonlight and roses stuff. It's about kindness and thinking about people and being compassionate. One of the most powerful messages, I think, is from the company of the musical Rent, who welcome us all to measure our lives in love. You know, isn't that a wonderful idea? Give love, get it back, see where it takes you. But what else? Being true to yourself. Now, there's a big message you get from the musicals. Oh, it sounds rather trite, doesn't it? You know, you do you, as the kids say these days, that kind of rubbish. But when you dig beneath the surface, you find being true to yourself is one of the most important things you ever need to remember. Anything you do, let it come from you, then it will be new. Give us more to see. Asks the character Dot in Sunday in the Park with George to the man she loves, but the man who won't give her that love back because he's so consumed with his art and has the passion of creation. Take me as I am. I mean, that's the mantra of Jekyll and Hyde. And Billy Elliot, I mean, he proves that you can express yourself whenever you want, even if the world around you isn't quite ready to see it. Being true to yourself features very heavily in the musicals set in schools. You know, whether it be the kids in Wicked learning that being different is okay, or the kids in Matilda learning that only really you can change your story, or the kids from Fame learning that there are downsides of wanting to live forever. You know, musicals set in schools also gravitate clearly towards a lesson. High School the Musical, hard work, dedication pays off. But you know, the kids in Heathers realize when you kill your friends, it doesn't always end up well. I think the greatest lesson we can take from musicals is just to connect. Connect, George. That's what the characters tell the artists in Sunday in the Park with George throughout the musical. Connect with someone, with something, with the world around you. People come into our lives for a reason, suggests the musical Wicked. And Once Upon a Mattress tells us it's okay not to be perfect. Now, there are so many lessons I could go on for hours, but let's be honest, I've got to wrap this up now. So I'm going to finish with two things. The first thing is from a character in the musical Company. And I think this is one of the lessons that I have always wanted to embrace, but never got quite close enough to really hug. Hey, buddy, don't be afraid it won't be perfect. The only thing to be afraid of really is that it won't be. And sticking with my love letter to Stephen Sondheim, perhaps I should finish with a lesson from his musical Into the Woods. As we, ostensibly a bunch of strangers, gather today to just connect with each other, someone is on your side. No one is alone. And you know what? That's a pretty awesome message. Thank you very much, guys, for listening.
Thank you so much.
I do like a McDonald's sometimes.
Thank you, Ray.
Thank you. Great. Hey, thanks so much for that, Ray. That was really amazing. And yeah, it is. There are so many different things that we can find in musicals, and I'm sure that everyone there was. There's going to have been at least a few things in there which everyone listening to this will resonate with. And, you know, it's not quite the same as when someone sings it from a stage, but we all know that there will be a message in Ray's talk, a message which has been taken from a musical, which you needed to hear right now. Yeah, only connect. That seems to be something which is really, really important. We are gonna, when this coronavirus is over, like I can see a lot of connection happening there. And so, yeah, we're now gonna have 2 minutes of 2 minutes of silence, in fact, because that's what we always do. It's 2 minutes to meditate, to reflect. So I'm just gonna say, wherever you are, just to go and shut your eyes now. Just shut your eyes and maybe just think about what was the message or lesson which you heard in Ray's talk, which really spoke to you the most. So let's enjoy this moment of reflection together. And now when you're ready, just to open your eyes and to rejoin us in the room. And yeah, if you're on gallery view, I don't know if you are, wherever that is, just to go and have a little look at all these wonderful people who are here. And there's going to be many people who you will have met before if you're a regular Sunday Assembly regular, but then there's going to be a lot of people who are here for the first time. And, you know, we're all connecting. We're all wanting a place to go and find that other humans to be with. And now I'm just going to sort of like say that, yeah, that we are Sunday Assembly, you know, like the Sunday Assembly London, which is organizing this, is a charity. And we, like Steph, who organizes it, does a huge amount of different activities during the notices. You're gonna hear about them. And at a time like this, this work is more important than ever. And so these are activities that you can join. They're activities which lots and lots of people are getting involved with, but it only works if there's a donation. Sunday Assembly is a charity. And so what I'm gonna ask you to do now is to please donate. I believe there's gonna be a link in the box. Now, there's some people I know who will have been really affected financially by the coronavirus crisis. And look, and if you are going through real financial hard times, we're not expecting a donation. But then if you do have the ability to donate, then what we say is we request £10. If you're on a low income, then £5. And I know there's going to be some people who are who have been locked up at home and are probably saving more money than ever, in which case that we would ask you, if you can, to donate more than £10, maybe £20. The link is going to be in the chat. You can also see the link there. So, yeah, please do give. And I hope that you're able to find it a joyful experience because you're giving something to an organization which gives joy and gives connection and gives pleasure. You can even just go and text in as well. And the way I'm thinking about this, this isn't just sort of giving for now. This isn't just giving for what's happening in this present moment. It's also sort of giving for what's going to come next, because coronavirus will be deleted, defeated, not deleted, well, deleted and defeated. Oh, am I coming through weirdly? Someone just said that I'm coming through quite. There we go. I don't know if this is going to be better now. And it's not only giving to what Sunday Assembly is doing now, but also to the activity in the future. So look, I hope everyone has had an opportunity to donate there. We're now going to go to the notices. We can hear all of the work that Sunday Assembly does to help people in this time of crisis. Please put your hand. Oh, no, my bad. To go and do this song right now. So it is I Know Him So Well from Chess.
So good, it lasts its Beautiful.
Porque le dan todo el protagonismo a este pobre niño, se anda muriendo de vergüenza. Ah, es el que cantó antes.
Ah, sí.
I'm just looking for Sanderson. Where is he? Did he log off?
I can't see him either. He dropped off for me.
Oh, here he is. He's coming back.
Entering the waiting room now.
Here we go. Sorry, just trying to spotlight
him. Sorry, guys, I got kicked out there, so I don't know if I don't know how long. I'm sure people have been able to keep on going, and everyone wasn't twiddling their Zooms. Have we yet started the notices? It would be because that's what we're doing now. Oh, all right, great. Perfect timing there. Sorry about that, technical tissues. We're going to do the notices so you can find out what is going on across the Sunday Assembly London world. So put your hand together for Gwar Thomas.
Hi, everyone. So my initial plan was to do the notices through the medium of musical theatre with a key change after every item, but I've got so many fabulous things to tell you about that I quickly realised I would run out of notes. Our next assembly is on the 18th of October, and the theme of that is Why Money Matters. Obviously, it's so that you can buy lots of tickets to go to lots of fun shows. But if you can't wait that long, then you can also go to one of our sister assemblies gatherings. We've got Brighton at 11 on the 11th, and the theme of that is Lost and Found. We've also got Manchester and Edinburgh currently meeting every week. Should say all online, so you don't have to spend a week's salary on train tickets only to find yourself on the rail replacement bus anyway. But in a classic example of branding fail, you might think, Sunday Assembly isn't actually just about Sundays, because we have got loads of events going on in between assemblies for you to connect with other members of the community. So every Monday at 7, the choir is still meeting up and rehearsing via Zoom. So do join in with that. Then on the 24th of October, 2 in the afternoon, we've got Board Games Club. Mitski is the person to contact for the Zoom link for that. If you like your activities a bit less sedate, on the 25th of October, the walking group is walking the Capital Ring section from Grove Park to Crystal Palace, and meet at Grove Park Station at 11:15 for that. I'm told that there will be dinosaurs, hope not real ones. But perhaps check the Facebook group to confirm that. Then on the 27th of October at 7, we've got the Lively Poets Society, our very own poetry group, who are doing a workshop with a guest poet. So special guest that I don't even know who they are. But if you go and look on the Facebook group, then I'm sure all will be revealed. And then on the 3rd of November, we've got the next meeting of the Article Club. If you don't know already, the Article Club is kind of a bit like a book club, but basically when you no longer have a long commute to go and read and devour huge tomes, so much shorter reading list than for a book club. But that said, if you do have time to binge read a book this week, then I'm told Sunday Assembly East End Book Club are meeting on the 11th of October at 4 o'clock to talk about Roald Dahl's novel, My Uncle Oswald. You can find out further info about all these wonderful happenings on the What's On page on our website, which is sundayassembly.com/events. And in fact, I can see Mitski's already ahead of me on the social media, but in particular, look out for our Facebook social group. You can find that just by searching for Sunday Assembly Social in the little bar at the top. And you will also find there details about our brand new sci-fi club. Very exciting. And finally, talking about social media, this entire community is run by a bunch of absolutely awesome volunteers, as you probably know. But we are currently on the lookout for another awesome volunteer to coordinate our comms and media. Comms and social media. So if you think that that awesome person could be you, then get in touch. So yeah, those are the notices. Thank you.
I particularly like the sound of the walking group, because that is a great way that you can go and be socially distanced, but together outside, no more than six, going backwards on a Tuesday if you're wearing pink, or whatever the rules are now around. I mean, frankly, I don't really know. Does anyone here, like, just go and wave your hands if you feel that you're totally on board with the rules as they stand at the moment? We've got James Rosen there. We've got Stephen Sin. I don't know. Stuart's gone like that, which I don't know. It's a bit confusing there. I think that's where I stand at the moment. Tell you the truth, often the government information announcements are not particularly useful at the best of times. It's one of the few places which I don't think would be improved if it was delivered in a musical number. You do know that when the Edinburgh Fringe starts again, there will be coronavirus the musical. And I'm just going to say that someone did actually in the comments mentioned 2020 the musical, and I just want to say, what a hate watch. What an absolute, you're going to go and look at that just to go and say I was there. And but we are getting through it one and all. And I do want to go and say thanks to everyone who joined. I think that one of the really real things that we do learn from musicals is that it is amazing to have a place where we're able to come together, and it's escapism, but I don't think it's escapism from necessarily from the world, no longer thinking about these things, because there is so much emotion. There's all of human life in the musical theatre, but I think it's sort of an escape to the world, often as we wish it would be. And I think that's why we come to these Sunday assemblies as well, which is like, this is a moment we can come together and it reflects the world as we would like it to be. A place where everyone's welcome, a place where, we can go and feel joy, where we can express ourselves, where we can go and think about the best things, and also sort of go and contemplate things which can often worry us in a safe way. And so I want to say thanks to everyone who helped make this musical happen, this musical Sunday Assembly. So I'm going to start off saying a big thank you to Faye, our wonderful poet. They did a fantastic job. Big thank you to Faye and Ray. Oh, how did I not notice that before? if only Faye was Packham, and then we could have had Packham and Rackham, which should start a sort of grocery business. Thanks to everyone who was involved in making the music videos as well. That was amazing. And to everyone who does all of the different things to make Sunday Assembly happen, we have now got one final song, and it is truly glorious. I was looking at Steph, and Steph did say, remember to mention your podcast. I would say something else if you're thinking, I really like the topics we discuss at Sunday Assembly, but I would like to go and think about them more. If you go and put the word lifefulness into your Spotify or wherever you get podcasts, I know there's a lot of podcast fans out there. I sort of launched a podcast 2 weeks ago. It's going really well. We're getting, had some amazing guests. We had Tim Minchin being the last guest. And it's all the sort of, basically, if you like Sunday Assembly, you'll like all the things that we discuss. Occasionally there's some swears in it, but we're all big boys and girls and people. That's about it. So thanks to everyone for joining. After the song, it is not the end of Sunday Assembly, because you can stay and chat and go and, really get to the bottom of what is your favorite musical. There we go. It's the last song. Aaron, please go and line it up. Oh my gosh. One day more. Les Mis, or Le Miserable, as it is in this translation. Kate Oliver has already downloaded the podcast. Thank you very much. Fantastic. That was amazing. I have just finished listening to a 50-part podcast on the French Revolution, and I think I learned more about it in those 4 minutes due to the amazing costuming, and I really finally think I grasped the emotion which was displayed on the barricade by Stuart with his fist in the air, wearing, I don't know, what it looked like, some girl's furry top. That was really, I get the revolution now. And it has been televised. Thanks so much for everyone for joining. Give yourselves all a big round of applause. I hope whatever the rest of the week and next week has in store for you, that you're able to deal with the tricky parts as well as can be, and are able to go and find solace and strength in the little moments of joy that it will provide you, because they're always there. Thanks so much. I hope everyone who stays has a great chat. And please go and subscribe and follow to Sunday Assembly London in all the relevant and different places. And ciao, ciao, goodbye. Enjoy the chats. Ciao, bye everyone, bye everyone. Bye, 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 bye.
Okay, if everybody could just take a minute to fill in the poll, and then we will do the breakout rooms.